Welcome to the People Who Read People podcast with me, Zachary Elwood. In this episode, recorded January 19th, 2021, I interview Jamie Haywood about medical research and healthcare and what he's learned in his career. There are many interesting accomplishments of Jamie Haywood's I could list, but I'll try to quickly summarize why he's an interesting person to me. In 1998, Jamie's brother, Stephen Haywood, was diagnosed with ALS, also known as Lou Gehrig's disease. People diagnosed with ALS typically live anywhere from 2 years to 10 years, and along the way, they lose more and more control over their muscles. ALS is what is sometimes called an orphan disease. It has so few sufferers that there's not a lot of financial incentives for researchers, which means there have been few new treatments for it. At that time, Jamie was 30 and worked at a biology think tank called the Neurosciences Institute. He had an engineering degree from MIT, had never taken a biology course, and was the so-called business guy at the think tank. When he heard his brother Stephen was sick, he essentially dropped everything and focused all his time on doing what he could to maximize his brother's chance of survival. He began researching everything about ALS and soon started an ALS nonprofit research organization, ALS Therapy Development Institute. The institute has done its own research, and as of today, it has raised over $100 million to research and treat ALS. Jamie wasn't from the medical world, so his approaches were controversial to some researchers. Because he was motivated to do what he could to save his brother, he wanted to get results fast. He didn't want to wait the usual long periods of time it can often take to do research and testing. His organization also opted for a so-called open-source science approach, which meant sharing findings as they made them and not waiting to get peer review. This was also controversial to some, but was in keeping with the goals of trying to move quicker than traditional processes allowed. These approaches got results and earned respect. Jamie's brother Stephen died in 2006. Jamie's work on ALS was featured in a New Yorker article in 2000 by Jonathan Weiner. And in 2004, Weiner wrote a book about it titled His Brother's Keeper, A Story from the Edge of Medicine. Jamie's work was also featured in a 2006 documentary called So Much, So Fast, which also follows his brother Stephen's struggle with ALS. It's a good documentary. I recommend it. It really makes you see and understand how horrible the disease is. In 2004, Jamie continued with his efforts to revolutionize medical research by being one of the founders of Patients Like Me, which was a platform for collecting medical data directly from patients using questionnaires and daily status reports. It also allowed people to connect with others who were going through similar things. In 2010, they made Fast Company magazine's list of most innovative companies, ranked at number 23. In 2016, co-founders Jamie and Ben Haywood were awarded the 2016 Humanitarian Award by the International Alliance of ALS/MND Associations. In 2017, Patients Like Me was chosen by Fast Company again, this time as one of the top 10 most innovative companies in biotech. In 2019, Patients Like Me was sold to United Health. Jamie was a co-founder of the biotech company AO Biome and is now a director there. I find Jamie Haywood interesting because his career in the medical industry began with emotions that I think all of us can relate to at one point or another. Anger about a loved one being ill, or anger about our own illness, and anger at a seemingly callous or incompetent system. I'll quote a snippet from Jamie from this interview, as I think it captures some of the emotional interest in his story.
I want to give tools to the next Jamie Haywood who's going to move mountains to save the person they love, that make them not have to invent what I've had to invent, that allows them to actually go after solving the problem properly with the proper, I want Google for physiology itself so that you can ask of biology, what shall I do? How do I do it? And then you can be answered. And then people can actually change their own lives and curves. And it'd be fun to take down these sort of church-like guilds that run the system now that are not particularly aligned with the people that I love and are ill.
I have my own personal story of why I find Jamie and these topics interesting. In 2015, I went from being in the best physical shape of my life to being very weak, having a lot of body pain, and feeling often like I had the flu. After many tests and doctor visits, I eventually accepted that I had so-called chronic fatigue syndrome, also referred to as myalgic encephalomyelitis. This was hard for me to accept at first because, like many people, I thought these were not real physical conditions, that I had something much more serious than that. But as I learned, my symptoms were pretty typical for these conditions. These are still mysterious and not understood conditions, although there is some great research being done now more than there's been in the past. It was very frustrating to learn how little was known about what was happening to me and even how little had been done to differentiate different symptom sets because my symptoms were quite different from other people I talked to about their symptoms. So for a time, I was very motivated to set up an open source project to collect a bunch of data about people's symptoms and their various traits and experiences, with the thought that these conditions were still so mysterious and understudied that we'd find some interesting correlations in the data. I was encouraged by this by two prominent CFS researchers, and I was going to make it my primary focus. This was in 2016. Then about 2 years after I first came down with the symptoms, they lifted dramatically and I felt significantly better. And when that happened, my motivation to work on the project also dried up, which I'm still kind of disappointed about in some ways because I had mapped out so many details about how the project would work. If you're curious to learn more about my experiences with that condition, you can go to a site I created for the project and where I documented my experiences. It's at cfs-me-network.com. And if anyone's interested in checking out the specs for that CFS data project, send me a message. I'm happy to share it as I don't plan on doing anything with it anytime soon. So to tie that back to Jamie Haywood's career path, I was also frustrated in similar ways with the lack of answers and treatments. There seems to be so much untapped potential in big data approaches to studying medical conditions, to finding out how symptoms differ across large populations, to finding what traits or experiences various populations share or don't share, to seeing what treatments are working for various populations. And I don't mean just for mysterious conditions like CFS, but even for more well-understood conditions. This approach of getting data from the public seems wide open, with so much potential. And strangely to me, it seems like it hasn't been embraced by the mainstream. So I wanted to ask Jamie about that. What are the obstacles to such data collection techniques becoming mainstream? Why haven't they? Am I mistaken in thinking that such approaches could be revolutionary? And more broadly, I think it's interesting to hear Jamie's thoughts on healthcare and medicine in general, because he's someone who started out so passionate and so idealistic in wanting to revolutionize the industry in big ways. And along the way, he's learned the realities of that industry. He's learned where he was perhaps wrong in his original ways of thinking about these problems. I usually edit these interviews, but I decided to not edit this interview down because I think if you're interested in healthcare topics, you'll enjoy it. At the end, we get to talking about broader, more philosophical issues like the arrogance and entitlement that can be present amongst some experts in a field, and the value that people who are new to an industry might have in terms of seeing problems differently, and the importance of removing ego from the equation when trying to solve a problem. We even talk a little bit about poker at the end of the interview, too. Okay, here's the interview with Jamie Haywood, founder of ALS TDI, co-founder of Patients Like Me, and co-founder and director of AO Biome. Hey, Jamie, thanks for coming on.
Great to be here, Zachary.
So I'll start with, I've been surprised how crowdsourcing of medical data from the public doesn't seem to have caught on in a major way, because there seems like so many interesting correlations you can make about health and genetics, potential correlations with such a huge amount of data at our fingertips. For example, there's still some mysterious and not well understood conditions like chronic fatigue syndrome. And it seems like crowdsourcing approaches to collecting large amounts of data would have so much potential power for getting a better understanding of all these conditions, being better able to categorize exact symptom sets and finding correlations for why some people have some symptoms and not others, things like that, or finding patterns related to how some people's ways of life might help or hurt certain conditions. So first, I'd like to ask, is my perception correct that crowdsourcing of medical data hasn't caught on in as big a way as its potentials would suggest?
I think the gist of what you're saying is accurate, that there is a massive amount of opportunity to understand the experience of illness through crowdsourcing and its management, by the way, because I think that it's not just, it is a good assumption that 90% of effective care is done sort of outside the medical system by behavioral or environmental changes. So I think the combination of both what's it like to have disease and what is the best way to live with it and manage it outside of the formal medical system. Crowdsourcing is a profoundly, maybe the best way to get that information. It is not caught on. And I think the reasons for that are very complex and speak more to issues with the medical system itself and its goals than they do to the issues of the technology or process of crowdsourcing.
And what are some of the obstacles you see that have prevented it from being a major game changer?
The first one is actually just alignment of goals and incentives. Medicine broadly, globally, falls into two basic buckets. One is, you know, commercial medicine or medicine based on incentives. And the other is sort of bureaucratic medicine, which is, you know, public health approaches. And the two buckets they reward the people in it in different ways. And, you know, on a bureaucratic level, you know, like all bureaucratic systems, and you know, and bureaucratic systems run police departments and military and all kinds of different government and other systems. In the end, the power or success within a bureaucracy has to do with your ability to control resources within the bureaucracy. And distributing power to users is just typically not a bureaucratic strategy. And so it takes an external force to push that. Now, it's not to say they're not good people. And there are great people in those systems that work hard to do that. And I've seen some amazing efforts at the VA, and there's some really cool efforts in the UK. Sweden has perhaps the best approach to that. But in general, I have a rule of thumb. People tend to do what put their children through college. So, you know, power, resources, salary accumulates to the accumulation of power, which does not involve distribution. And then in commercial systems, I'll just be directly cynical for a second. And I think that people misunderstand how the U.S. medical system works. In general, what you have in the U.S. medical system is a series of boxes that are looking for profit units. A profit unit is a patient, and their job is to run the patient through the box in such a way that they maximize margin and profit. You know, they never talk about it that way. That's not what they actually say it is. But if you look at a hospital department or, you know, a pharmaceutical pill or even a pharmacy, they make no different amount of money about whether they effectively or ineffectively treat someone. In fact, some of them, they make more money if they are ineffective. And there's no feedback loop that regulates pricing in that context. And so, you know, you end up with these sort of odd effects where things like, you know, counseling for diabetes is much more cost effective, but the margins are lower. And so people do bariatric surgery in that context. And so I could give hundreds and hundreds of examples of this. And the evidence is sort of overwhelming. That's the way it is. You know, in that case, the use of crowdsourced data, where it is generally able to more effectively refine who will benefit from a therapeutic, while there are, again, most people will work to do that on an individual basis at a system level, the incentives generally run against that, except for some small recent changes with the ACA that have created some incentives at the margins for improved outcomes. I know that sounds really cynical and awful, but I mean, that's been 22 years of doing this. And I'm like, that's the market. And the reason that our company, Patient Like Me, that I started with my brother and friend, was able to have an impact was we actually employed kind of a jujitsu business model where we would look for capital flows. And we did work in ME-CSF was one of the areas that you talked about. It had 75,000 people that were tracking data. It was a spectacular amount of data in the disease. Is that you look for someone that's making money, and you would either charge them for data that would help them make more, or you charge someone that was paying them for data that would help them make less. And that was the way we would do it. But it's very on the margins in terms of making the system more efficient.
I am obviously not an expert, and it could be done quite well in other countries. But it just seems like in the U.S. at least, the incentives are not aligned in the same way that so many industries seem like incentives aren't aligned and seem like they're ready for being completely revolutionized in different ways. And sort of like in, you know, real estate too, where the incentives aren't aligned in the sense that a realtor doesn't have an incentive to save you money, things like that. And I'm curious, are there things happening now that you see as revolutionizing that whole model?
So now I want to go and sort of talk about the other side of the complexity in this, because I think that, you know, there's a reason that physicians are trained for so long. The reason is that actually making decisions in medicine is quite hard. And the interaction of different approaches, the potential for harm that is largely managed at the individual decision maker level. The physician is the one that does that. So the physicians are work very hard to attempt to do the right thing in a system that creates incentive not to do the right thing. And when we talk about evidence here, so let's look at what it takes to move the needle on these things. So medical evidence can kind of come in a few categories. One is kind of, duh, this is a good idea, right? And then after that, you have to sort of manage the consequence of that. And there's a lot of that, you know, like if you have an appendicitis, we generally know how to produce a pretty good outcome and improve that, or an ulcer, which can be treated with, you know, antibiotics. There's a bunch of things where you get these sort of very profound effects for fairly straightforward, you know, interventions that can have a significant impact on the patient. But when you get to more subtle things, this is where the problem of medical evidence starts to emerge, which is that getting evidence that something has an effect for some population is quite challenging. And clinical trials are very expensive to do well. They're very hard to do. They're very hard to isolate the biases in the information and actually get a proper signal out of them. And so in that case, we end up with extremely sort of spotty data where you have some information which has commercial support that is quite comprehensive, even if the signal is not strong. And to compete with that on a real world evidence basis, which might be a better way of phrasing than crowdsourcing, the ability to produce really credible, verifiable hypotheses that have demonstrated support that cannot be criticized for being built off of bias or other effects is very, very hard. And so I think that there's a combination where the bar of giving information to a physician to allow them to make a thoughtful decision to improve a treatment decision is hard in a system that does not really create much economic incentive to produce that data. And it's the combination of those two that make this very, very hard to disrupt. And then a lot on top of that, talking about medicine is a little bit like talking about transportation, where you are comparing walking to jet airplanes. They are both transportation, but they have quite different variables of optimization and infrastructure requirements and costs. And so medicine is an extremely diverse field with, you know, almost call it dozens or even hundreds of micro markets that are all running by different parameters that all need different kinds of evidence standards. So disrupting this is, I actually think, literally perhaps the hardest thing there is left to fix in the human economy.
It makes sense. I mean, I think a lot of people tend to take a simplistic view of these topics and not understand that there are actually many good reasons why it is so hard to disrupt it. I think people can have a more cynical view of things than is actually, you know, warranted by the complexity of the topic.
I think I started with this is pretty easy, you know, when I started doing this, and the hard won lessons of, you know, failing a lot, which is what you do. You get better at discriminating why people do things that seem irrational. And I think, you know, one of the sort of disappointing things, and I think this is more broader than just medicine. I think today people are like, well, obviously this is the case, you know, whatever the topic is, political, right, whatever. But they fail to look at the sort of second order effects or nuances. And, you know, and I think medicine is that on steroids, pun intended, which is sort of dysregulated in its ability to manage these secondary effects. So I spawn myself in this sort of profoundly cynical state. When I relate to medicine, I approach everything with this unbelievable skepticism, but also with empathy for how hardworking and dedicated the people are in it, in a system that really works against the best of human interest.
Mm-hmm. And I want to get back to that and the lessons you've learned at the end. And I want to go back now to the other potential obstacles that you've seen with, you know, as you call it, real world evidence collecting, obstacles to that. And I want to ask a few questions about that and see if I have some right ideas about some other obstacles there may be. Are there some fears of medical confidentiality issues that can get in the way of these kinds of data collecting techniques?
That's complicated. Let's break that into a few components. I think it is essential that medicine has a right to privacy. And what I mean by that is that it is inappropriate for someone that needs care to feel that that information about them would be used against them in some other context or could be used to discriminate or harm them. And I think that's essential. I think privacy as practiced, particularly in the United States, ends up being, you know, almost the worst it can be, which is that essentially by HIPAA, the information is licensed to be used for every purpose except for improving medicine. So you know, you can send it to your insurer and you can be used, like all of this information is compiled into a dossier about you that everyone that might be able to discriminate against you has access to, except for maybe your employer. And by the way, we sell all that data. All that data is available in the open market. I mean, so everyone's medical records are for sale without their names on it. But it's a bit like saying,
it's like Facebook selling anonymized user data, kind of that idea.
Yeah. And how hard would it be to match someone against, you know, 200 data points? It's not that hard, right? Mm-hmm. I don't know who you are, but you're age 63 and you go to Walgreens every Thursday at 3:00, right? You know,
I see.
So the data is sold and extracted, but initially at some level, the primary use of that data, which would be to how do I improve care at the physician level, is not really possible. So it's kind of depressing in that context. The other thing I think about privacy is I think it's misunderstood. In the United States, we tend to regulate privacy as not allowing the use of data, the sharing of data, sorry, not the use. We don't allow the sharing of data. What privacy really generally means to people is they want to be left alone. I used to joke at patients like me that if we could set the privacy setting, please give my data to everyone in the world except my Facebook friends. That would be the one that most users selected. And the reason is, it's not that they don't want other people to have the data to make their lives better. It's just they don't want to talk about their crap with their friends. If I have a polyp removed or something wrong, I kind of want to go out with a beer for the guys without being held accountable for that. But if someone else could learn from that experience and have a better outcome, of course I'd want it. So we worked very hard at using the data in that way, sort of taking the honored intent of the users, which is to say, look, we can't guarantee anonymity, but we will use the data in such a way that we will help as many people as possible and sort of keep it in a different box than in the rest of the world's data for you so that you're not confronted with it. And I think that was one of the reasons that Patients Like Me was quite successful in that context. Now, the other side of this beyond privacy, I think there's some definitions issue in medicine. EMRs and the practice of medicine collect data for essentially a primary and a secondary purpose. The primary purpose is to document what was done in order to maximize the ability to generate revenue. So it documents actions, but not information about the individual. And one of the reasons for that is that if you collect almost too much information about the individual, the computer can second guess your actions. Ideally, what you really want to do is you want to collect the minimum amount of data allowing you to justify doing something, but no more, because it would justify questioning it. And the second thing is, the more data you collect on the experience of the user, the more liability you create. So the secondary purpose of data collection is to reduce liability. And so if you think about something that would be designed to create an information source that would be essentially useless for comparing people and determining what worked, you would design something with those two purposes.
I see what you're saying, yeah.
And it's sad, but unfortunately it means, so I've always envisioned in medicine, I like to think of there being three people in the room. You know, there's the clinician, there is the patient, and then there is the patient to come. And I think that we need to sort of establish a new kind of malpractice, which is that if you do not collect the information in the encounter that would improve the care for the patient to come, then you have committed malpractice against that future patient. And essentially, medicine today commits malpractice every day because we fail to collect the data to support the patient to come. And the overwhelming evidence for this is that the clinical trial system, which is a very large industry of almost several $100 billion, never uses unfiltered medical records as part of their architecture. Mm-hmm. So the system that is designed to produce evidence of benefit essentially to the 99th percentile statement does not use medical data. It has to create its own custom proprietary data set in order to establish that evidence, which says to me that you can't result in that unless you design the system to not collect the data you need.
To restate the extent of this problem, I mean, to me, it just seems like, as you're saying, there's just so much actionable information and data that is being lost that just seems like such a crazy amount of theoretically powerful data, you know, like going to the doctor and giving them information about your condition, what your current status is, you know, how you're responding to various medicines, combinations or whatever. You know, there's just so much data, and it just seems to be, as you're describing these problems, it just seems to be lost or inactionable for the most part, you know, and that is the problem that we're discussing.
There's a component to that. You know, if you look at the information system for early discovery and the information system for clinical development and the information system for clinical care are fully disconnected, and they have completely different purposes. In early discovery, you want to ask as broad a set of questions as possible in a diverse context to find the opportunity to have the best impact on someone. And so you're looking for the diamond, right? In clinical development, what you are looking to do is to ask the smallest number of questions in the most precise way so that you can prove that the diamond has value. And then once you've done that, you know, again, outside of Sweden, which runs these very high quality registries, there are almost no medical systems that check whether the diamond is either A, being used in the right place, or B, does the same thing that we learn in the clinical trial in the real world. And so what happens is we end up treating, you know, millions of people based on evidence in thousands without ever checking in the millions on whether the data was right in the first place. And with the false positive rate in science and the biases for selecting for the things that have false positives, that means that a lot of the evidence, particularly in things like mental health, we end up using medicines that when you really look at them, don't have any real evidence that supports them. And we don't ever check in the real population whether it makes any impact.
So have you seen the respect for these crowdsourced real-world data collection techniques? Has the respect for them grown over time? Have you seen that happen?
No, I don't think so, actually. There's two really famous studies. One is the Framingham Heart Study, and the other is the Nurses Study, that have produced, and these are sort of real-world observational studies. They're not crowdsourcing so much, though. Again, I would use real world rather than crowdsourcing as the right way to describe that.
Oh, and let's talk about that really quick. What is it that you don't like about crowdsourcing, that term?
So what is crowdsourcing? Crowdsourcing means that people are volunteering or contributing, you know, automatically to like Waze. Waze is crowdsourcing, right? So they're contributing automatically to the whole information set. And when you look at clinical research, when you volunteer to join a study, you are crowdsourcing, right? So I think at some level, clinical research itself, because it's basically done on volunteers, is crowdsourcing.
It's a form of crowdsourcing.
Gotcha. And I think when you use the word crowdsourcing, what it tends to do is discount the importance of the structure of the information collection. So I could buy or crowdsource a million medical records. That's done all the time. To me, the more important question is thinking about what is the digital framework for how you structure the information that is needed. And then crowdsourcing is a way of getting some of that information more accurately and effectively.
Is patient-reported data, is that also accepted, or is that a different kind of term?
Patient-reported data is very important. It basically is because that how does the person quantify their experience in such a way that it can be compared across populations or individuals. And that is that Patients Like Me was essentially a patient-reported data crowdsourcing platform. But I think, you know, clinical trial is the same. The difference is whether it's mediated by a website and more self-motivation and digital rewards, or whether it's mediated by a physician-patient relationship and on-site. And that's all merging now with different companies doing different methodologies that bridge that. So it's, sometimes these words, they convey something, but when you really get down to it, what we're talking about is what is the kind of information we need to answer a question or to solve a problem? And how do we most efficiently work with the people that have that information to get it? And I think that's a more helpful way of thinking about it. And it also allows you to adapt it to the different problems, which are quite different between pancreatic cancer or diabetes or, rheumatoid arthritis or MS or depression. They all have very different needs.
And sorry, I think I interrupted you, and then I feel like I've lost the thread of what you were originally saying when I interrupted you about the crowdsourcing language. You were going to say something, and sorry about that.
Well, let's go back. There was another thing you wanted to talk about, I think, which is like what are the issues with collecting this? And you talk about patient-reported outcomes. I mean, so one of the huge issues in medicine is the lack of specificity of terms. You know, we talked about ME/CSF or fibromyalgia earlier, and you brought that up as an example of an opportunity. I think it's an excellent example. There are about 20 variably described pain fatigue syndromes. Mm-hmm. It could even be more depending on the definition group you did. And the overlap on those is quite substantial, which means that if I had a physician that saw a patient and another physician that saw the same patient, the probability they would come up with the same answer for the disease is quite low. Mm-hmm. So it's very hard to solve a problem if you can't define what it is you're talking about. And when you look at something like a disease or syndrome, which is what ME/CSF would be, what you're really describing is a constellation of symptoms with variable amounts and ranging from some to severe. And when we collected data on this, what we did is we said, look, we don't really care what disease you have, but we're going to look at these 25 symptoms and we're going to measure and quantify them over time. And then what we'll do is we'll do cluster analysis or factor analysis to figure out what people like you look like. And it turns out that the diagnosis of the disease is not a, particularly in mental health is another area, is not a particularly good cluster analysis or factor analysis approach, that you really need to look at the fundamental information. And one of my favorite papers was published, and it said, I'm going to get the number wrong, but it's close to this. with 6 million, there are 6,500,000 ways to have depression. And, you know, so what is depression, right? Well, you know, you can have depression when your mom dies. You can have depression because you have a genetic anomaly that makes you susceptible to that. You can have depression because you lie. Like, there's all kinds of ways of having depression. And yet we treat them all the same as if they're the same. And then we talk about disease like HIV, which is very specific. I can know, you know, down to the base pair, the exact virus that is infecting you and, mm-hmm. and damaging your immune system. So that is specific, right? So you range from this, I know the exact base pair of the virus, you know, which gives me a couple of hundred data points. This is exactly what you are, to you have severe depression, which doesn't really tell me anything at all. And so we mix these terms across disease, treatment, experience, symptomology. And when you add it all up as an engineer, you're like, how do I make something out of these non-specific components? And I think so the biggest problem about medicine is actually defining what it is we're talking about.
Right. Yeah, no, and I haven't told you this, but you might have. Yes, I have some interest in these topics, and it's because I have, you know, the chronic fatigue syndrome constellation of symptoms. And I hesitate to even call it chronic fatigue syndrome because these things seem so undefined. But in 2015, I went from being in the best shape of my life to being very weak and hurting and having cognitive issues and things like that. And I eventually accepted that I had this constellation of things called chronic fatigue syndrome, aka ME. And that's what motivated my interest in this, was just the fact that they couldn't even seem to define symptom sets. And my symptom set was very different from people I talked to about it. You know, I, for example, like when I pressed down on my skin, it hurt, you know, pretty much anywhere in my body. And that was a unique, you know, fairly unique symptom set. And it just kind of shocked me that there hadn't been a big data approach to collecting this and separating the symptom sets into, you know, different categories, as you're saying. Because if you can't even define the symptom set, how are you going to understand it or treat it?
So I completely agree with you. And in fact, you know, given we did a lot of work in that area, I think what's, I'm going to tell you this, a little disappointing. I think that is important, but I do not think it's going to yield the answer alone. And why I say, what I mean by that is, and maybe we'll just talk about sort of some of the errors in thinking about health. There are many examples in medicine of what I'd call point causes and specific symptoms. So we go back to HIV, you know, we have a point cause that a specific disease is caused by a specific vector. And that disease manifests itself as a loss of a certain immune function, which then manifests itself as the advancement of a series of things like some cancers or some pneumonias that ultimately kill you, right? So you have that, that's a fairly causal chain that we can describe. Or I can take a disease like ALS that I used to work on, where a certain gene SOD, when mutated, causes the disease at certain ages. And you can basically build, even though we don't know all the elements of the causal chain, you can build a causal chain where this causes that, right? But the vast majority of medicine, like what you experienced, is much more nuanced. And, you know, whether you people call it chronic Lyme, people call it lupus sometimes, like what you have is you have, and by the way, I'm sure you had the awful experience where people just said, well, it's all in your head, get over it.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Of course.
And to validate your pain, in my measurement in our system, the patients with the worst quality of life were the ones with the pain fatigue syndrome. So just absolutely the worst quality of life without question. So you have something profoundly wrong with you. You knew something was profoundly wrong with you.
Yeah. I thought I was dying. Yeah. At one point. And then it got better, but that's a whole nother story.
But how and why, and then you have these sort of false causalities in that. And I find it unlikely that there's going to be a single virus or a single bacterium that's going to be found to be accountable for ME/CSF. What I think we're going to find is that there are 40 or 50 ways, or some number of ways, more than three and less than hundreds, that your immune system can become dysregulated through some internal signaling failure.
Right. Post-viral or whatever reactions to some combination of factors.
Yeah. Right. A multiplicity of causes that could cause that, you know, including just an injury, like, you know, just something, some miscommunication, some game of telephone in your body as it talked to itself failed. And then it replicated that failure. And then that made your system go out of balance. And The risk of that has to do with a series of resilience, potential resilience levels in your body, where it can tolerate some level of miscommunication at times or not. And you ended up with a perfect storm. You know, there was a miscommunication where a series of resilience gaps existed that produced a sustained dysregulation of a system that we can't measure because we don't have the tools to measure it yet, that produced this set of symptoms, which were similar to other people that have different kinds of dysregulations for different causes, right? That is the cluster. And nothing about the way we approach medicine in looking for, quote, targets to treat or the consistent experience of disease is going to tell us a lot about that. And this is the ultimate fuzzy map to fuzzy map sort of machine learning problem that I love, but is not compatible with the way we research and care for medicine patients right now. And to me, the really depressing thing about it, if you look at longevity or life or mental health, all of these core elements that are central to how we live our lives, they are all that same problem. And we are not even approaching them with approaches that have any hope of addressing the problem.
Yeah, and I didn't mean to imply that these approaches would necessarily solve or find a root cause. It just seemed to me, like as you were saying, by collecting so much data, it seems like you could find correlations. You know, for example, even as something like, oh, I have the dry earwax gene and people with that are more prone to getting this. You know, some random piece of correlation that might give you insight into what may be happening for like specific symptom sets. And that just seems to be an approach that could be taken for so many other things, like maybe some people with X condition are more likely to have Y condition, and there's some learning to be found there. Would you agree with that general idea that is one of the main strengths of these approaches?
I absolutely believe what you're saying, and I have been operating to that principle for everything I've done, ALS-TDI, patients.
Right, that's your whole, yeah.
Patients like me, genetic networks, right. even AOBiome, like all, every company I've done at CoverNex was all built around that principle. And it's gotten more or different or more sophisticated approaches to that. And I'm going to sum it up to say it has not been enough. Mm-hmm. And it was not that I did the systems wrong or I designed it wrong. I think the most important work and the closest I got was a program we built called Digital Me at iCarbonX. And I think that goes to where I believe. So look, I believe this problem is solvable, but I believe that we are going to have to simultaneously solve a series of problems at the same time in a way that is very hard for the world to do. And that's kind of what I've been spending the last 12 months planning and thinking about how to do correctly. We need, in what you just said about, like genetic risk factors that make things more likely, that is a important domain of health. And that has yielded insights into targets for treatment. But the challenge of that approach, if you look at something like ME/CSF or mental health, two broadly syndromic sets of conditions, the risk factor genes number in the hundreds. And I'll give you another good example. I just read a paper yesterday that looked at in height, where we can now genetically account for about 50% of the variance in human height. It takes 10,000 different genetic inputs to make that calculation. Mm. So when you're looking at 10,000 inputs or hundreds of inputs versus hundreds of outputs in terms of variations in symptoms over time quantified, you essentially end up with a sort of one of those machine learning problems where the amount of data to solve it is so big that it's unachievable. And I view the reason we have been unable to succeed at this to date with the different efforts, but there's a series of reasons. One reason is we are not very good at managing the quality of de novo biological inputs. So I do not know of anyone other than a little bit of the work that we did at Digital Me and a few other small efforts where someone has been able to longitudinally collect high quality state biology. So I'm not talking about genetics, I'm talking about RNA or proteins or metabolites reliably over time in a population of individuals. So you can get the essentially vector signature of how these objects move in the individuals over time. No one's ever done that comprehensively or well with high quality control where the noise in the information is low enough to be particularly useful. And that's a hard problem. And it requires a skill set that is not generally in academic medicine or even in biology. It's more of a manufacturing, it's like the kind of skill set you need to make perfect screens. You know, like how do you get a million pixels on a screen that don't make any errors, right? That's hard. The second thing that we don't have is really thoughtful specificity about phenotype. What is a disease? What is a symptom? How do you collect that information consistently? And so we have at the biological input layer, a lot of noise. At the biological output level, at the experience of disease and health, bad information. And we do not control for factors that are not connected to the problem at hand. So if I'm trying to look at ME-CSF, I mean, I'll give you a protein that I know is central in that disease. IL-6 is highly activated in ME-CSF patients. It's an inflammatory cytokine. It's also highly activated in obese patients. It's also highly activated in people that didn't sleep very well last night. So if you do not explain the variance in each of these objects by diet, sleep, all a bunch of acute factors, you are not explaining what part of it contributes to the disease. And then the most important part of all of this is the sort of what I call the false engineering belief, which is that somehow biologists in general tend to believe that God was an engineer. You know, I've done enough evolutionary work to know that he's not an engineer. Like he does not make things that cause causal, you know, as cool as the eye is, it doesn't work like the brake system in a car. All of biology is multiplexed. And in no way more than you and I know how we understand or coming to the things that we're saying in this conversation, does your body say specifically what made it make a decision? It integrates everything. And so our theory of physiology is through these false diagrams and false thinking, where we believe humans can explain causal chains in complex multiplicity. And it's like my saying, well, the neuron on my eye connected to the neuron on my neuron, and I can explain how these neurons made my happy conclusion. Bullshit. Right. what we have is these complex networks. And so we have to think about the network architecture itself. And those three problems, when solved, which is, you know, what I'm trying to work on now and define how to do that at scale across much of medicine, you can't just do this in one area, it is going to yield the information in the network that will tell us how to tune ourselves to address the issue that you faced in 2015 and help you guide yourself to being better, because we'll have the map, just like Waze. But until we build that, we're just sort of tilting at windmills.
That's what I find so interesting about your story, that you started from a frustrated and idealistic, point in your, when you started on this path with your brother's illness, and you've learned so much about the obstacles that prevent that from being, you know, these things being a simple solution. And that's why I find your story so, you know, A, interesting, and two, educational and even inspirational, in the sense that you did make big changes and big contributions as an outsider to the industry while learning, you know, you learned all of the hard lessons along the way. Yeah. So maybe that's a good segue into if you could go back to the early days of, starting the ALS organization, would there be things that you would do differently in terms of how you approached those problems? Like maybe either take it slower or focus on a different area. What were some of the major learnings that you would take back in time, I guess, is the question.
That's a great question. So it's funny, you know, thinking to myself, I'm really stubborn and I'm brutally self-critical.
Good qualities.
Yeah, maybe. I haven't done anything right yet, and I'm really going to keep working at it. But anyway, yes, there's something I would definitely change. When Stephen first got sick, I began to scour the world for ideas for how to save him. And ALS, the ALS Therapy Development Institute, was a machine that was designed to test ideas to put in Stephen. It was his only purpose. And I built a portfolio and evaluated them. We did the first stem cell transplant in ALS that was published. We tested hundreds and hundreds of drugs, many of which Stephen took and some of the clinical trials we did and sort of personal clinical trials we did both ways. But the problem with a disease like ALS is it's a little bit like playing soccer, and you don't get a lot of goals. And I really realized, and I should never do sports metaphors because I'm terrible at sports, but you really want to be playing basketball rather than soccer. And if you want to play basketball, because if every shot only has a 1 in 100 chance of scoring, which I think is probably a reasonable number for medicine, you really want to be taking a few hundred shots. You don't want to be taking one per game, right? So or three per game, whatever it is. So how do you do that? And I think I've come to believe, and this goes back to defining that architecture problem I just described of the network and the high quality biology and the high quality phenotype, connecting those three, that what is the most important thing in medicine is to solve the problem of how quickly can you understand the effectiveness of a therapeutic in an individual. I'll repeat that. How long does it take to understand the effectiveness of a therapeutic in an individual? My brother had ALS. When we put him on a treatment, it would take us probably several years to have confidence that it had impact on his own personal direction. And so we only had the chance to take 3 or 4 shots in his lifetime on that disease. When you have a proxy biomarker like cholesterol for heart disease, which is not perfect, or viral load for HIV, you can do things much faster. You can try something, and if it moves the biomarker in a month, you know that you're having an impact. And I think that's why HIV became something tractable, because we had a good biomarker for how effective the treatment was. And that biomarker meant that we found treatments and multiple times of them and multiple generations of them quickly. And that's why HIV has gone from being a, essentially universally lethal, 8-year survival to essentially an almost well-managed lifetime with moderate manageable effects. And that happened in diabetes, which also had a quick profile. It's happened in CML, which you can measure with a quick blood test. So to me, the only goal is to find the network of proximal markers for our goals for both better health and less disease, and to do it multiplexed so that we integrate all the information effectively to that task. And if we do that, and think if I'd done that at ALS-TDI in the beginning, if I put all the money into, rather than testing drugs in mice, which is important, but really discovering biomarkers in humans with the best available technology, I think I might've had a better chance of bending the curve for Steven. Now, the problem with that pitch to someone that's, ill is it is a two-step process. First, you have to find the problem you want to solve, and then you have to solve it. And even though the second part of that problem is much faster, so we have to get going now. And my dream is, I think about myself, and I interact with young people or people that are trying to come into the field a lot. I want to give tools to the next, Jamie Haywood, who's going to move mountains to save the person they love, that make them not have to invent what I've had to invent, that allows them to actually go after solving the problem properly with the proper, I want Google for physiology itself, so that you can ask of biology, what shall I do? How do I do it? And then you can be answered. And then people can actually change their own lives and curves. That's the dream I see and change. And it'd be fun to take down these sort of church-like guilds that run the system now that don't particularly, are not particularly aligned with the people that I love and are ill.
Obviously, you were motivated by some frustration with the status quo when you started out on this path. And has that been a big factor for you? Is it still a factor for you along the way, being frustrated with missed potentials?
My business partner and I went for a walk the other day, and we were talking about what frustrates us in people. And I think I would broaden that to systems. I hate hypocrisy. Oh my God. I can't. It's so motivating to me. And I really don't like self-righteousness. self-righteousness and hypocrisy are profound motivators to me. And to skewer hypocrisy and to poke at self-righteousness are it's like that's I love to do that. And I think I will say I've lost hundreds of friends to ALS, and my brother that was you know, dearest friend and someone I love so much, I can't even describe it. But I don't hate the disease. The disease is actually, as a scientist, it's actually quite beautiful in its architecture and the way it holds knowledge, and it helps me to understand the body. And we still have so much more to do there, though we've made a lot of progress. I hate the system that refuses to learn. And that motivates me.
It feels like there's, you know, in many aspects of medicine and just industries in general, there's this kind of tribalism or smugness about, we know this because we are this group or whatever. It's not so much hypocrisy as it is. Yeah, I guess you said it was self-righteousness. Yeah, it was feeling like we have the answer.
Well, there's entitlement.
Entitlement. Yeah, that's
there's entitlement. Better. Yeah. I think there's a general thing there that I want to touch on. And my dad's an engineer. I'm an engineer. My dad's dad was an engineer. And at MIT, we're sort of trained in a way of thinking that isn't about, and I'm a mechanical engineer, that isn't about mechanical engineering. It's a way of thinking about how things connect, right? Systems dynamics is one way I tend to think about problems. It's just a way of understanding how systems operate that live in the real world. I think that we have become enamored of specialization and knowledge and not about how to think as a society. And I believe that we would be far better served if our degrees with the PhDs attached to them, and I say this as having a bachelor's degree, where the honor was awarded to the quality of your thinking and not to your ability to memorize a field of knowledge. Because I don't believe that knowing lists of things particularly creates understanding. And I think that is largely how we have begun to train the world. And I think learning how to think logically and to question whether you are right or not is less trained. And so I am worried that we are strengthening the guilds in their current knowledge as opposed to training the people that would challenge it and bring it to a new level. And that's something that's nothing to do with medicine. I think it's the way we approach the world today, politics, everything.
To take it to that more general problem, I think it is people's need for certainty and their inability to admit, to be humble and say, I am uncertain about X, you know, that they've studied for a while. I mean, I think that is, even for people that haven't studied something for a while, we have a need for certainty that manifests in all of these, in so many problems that we have, that people are just unwilling to be like, I know a small smidgen of what is out there, you know, just being able to admit that is the big problem.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with that. And I think people are afraid to hold the possibility that what they believe is likely wrong. I have been cultivating this for 20 years now, or even longer. I literally commit the practice. I call it the joy of being wrong. Mm-hmm. And the joy of being wrong is, oh my God, I get a chance to learn something. I screwed up. You know, and it's like you can really do it. I have two children. One of them is a little bit, I'm working on his pride because he's like, he doesn't like being wrong. I'm like, you have to love being wrong because otherwise you're not learning.
I mean, that is the nature of strong thinking. And that's why it's so hard. It's because you have to form ideas and hypotheses about how the world works and yet still be willing to just completely throw that away for something when you're shown that it is not working, which is, those two combinations of things are very hard. And there's a reason that people struggle with that and are threatened by, you know, I might have to throw away this thing that I've committed, you know, 20 years of my life on or whatever. I mean, that there's a reason why people get committed to ideas and schools of thought.
It's fine. Bring this back to sort of you for a second here. A couple of days ago, I started teaching my kids, my boys are 12 and 10, to play Texas Hold'em.
Sweet.
And I love this game. It's an amazing game, right? It's such a brilliant, fascinating, so beautiful, and it's complex. I mean, we were talking about the definition, you know, it's bluffing, lying, and lying, and like, you can't lie in our household, but bluffing's a different thing. And it's like bluffing's a wonderful concept, right? You can't do business without bluffing, right? What I love is I find that poker players in general are high quality thinkers.
You have to be both stubborn and very critical, self-critical of your ideas. You have to be willing to say, just completely throw out something that's not working and be able to, willing to examine what's not working. And that's harder than people think.
is also built on the idea that in the end, success is made up of being wrong an awful lot, just being right a little bit more than
right. It's just it's a matter of fractional edges, right?
And, exactly. You know, so if you said to me, what should we teach scientists? And playing poker might not be a bad thing to teach them. Mm-hmm.
Do you feel like sometimes you probably address that, but you know, new people to an industry can see things that are either not apparent to people that are embedded in that industry or just overlooked for entitled reasons. Do you feel like that's the case sometimes?
In fact, if you look at some of the greatest people in the world, like George Church or Bob Lang, or some of the most amazing scientists that have made things happen, you know, it is when someone comes from one discipline, another discipline, to another with a different way of thinking that it becomes transformed. And the other version of that I love is, I forget who said this, but it's a great phrase. Like, it is necessary, but not sufficient for the leaders of a field to reject an idea for it to be useful. New ideas operate against the dogma. They always do. Mm-hmm. And the ones that work are always that way. It's just the experts disagreeing doesn't make you right, but it does mean that you might be important.
And I was just reading about attachment theory, you know, in the early 1900s, and how this common sense idea that how much love your parents show you when you're young will be a healthy factor for making you a stable person was like in doubt and actively castigated by the psychology community, who was enraptured in this Freudian kind of cold world where it was all about these abstract fantasies and things like that. But, you know, that just the idea that how a mother interacts with her child would have a positive or negative effect was in doubt and even, you know, mocked by these people. And it's just a great example of like, how could these people get it so wrong, you know?
Well, bring that forward to our current political climate and ask the question, is anyone uncertain about what they believe to be the right answer?
That's what bugs me. I criticize, you know, things on the left and right frequently, because the thing that bugs me on across the board is this certainty. And, you know, in a similar way, it's taking this small piece of information like X happened, this or a little video got played, and I know exactly what all the factors are in this one clip of video that has, in reality, has so many factors behind it.
I am certain that I am uncertain.
Mm-hmm. That's all I'm certain of, which is a admittedly hard way to be. And there's a reason people avoid that feeling of uncertainty, because it is scary.
Which brings us back to poker.
Right. That's the reason poker is profitable. So profitable because people, it's the Dunning-Kruger thing of, I want to be certain, A, and B, I think a complex thing is simpler than it is.
Yes. Yeah, that's funny. Actually, I hadn't thought about that too. But like, if you think about, as you said, you know, at one level, as I drew the rules out for my kids, Texas Hold'em is a very simple game, right? Here's the rule. Here's what wins. Just like biology, it's very simple, right? These things cause each other.
Right. Yeah. Just find the genes. Just find the.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You know, by the way, on the find the genes thing, you know, it's a little bit to me, finding the genes is like counting the letters in a book and believing that you know something about it. And then you discover, well, hey, there's words. Okay. Well, then you discover that those words actually have to be in a sentence to mean something, and that there are periods and all. It's like, you know, we're so at the beginning of this understanding thing. It's just so frustrating to hear people describe things to me. And
well, that is, as you say, you know, that is the major misunderstanding about genes, like that there's some gene that does X and that is its function, as opposed to it's just a chaotic mess of things interacting in ways that we have no real idea about for the most part.
Maybe a way of thinking about it is that there must be some gene that makes biologists certain that a gene does something that we have to find.
That's getting very meta there. Is there anything you'd like to talk about that we haven't talked about?
Well, I'm really excited to get going on what I want to do next, because I believe that we can understand the system to a degree that our current knowledge will be, I think over the next decade, if we do this correctly, we will be looking back at what we know today and the way we looked back at leeches as a practice of medicine in its ignorance. And I'm very excited for that transition, because I think if we can figure out what health is, which we have no idea what it is, and we can map how our chemistry, environment, behavior, actions create it, we create a potential path to heal not just individuals, but society and therefore the world itself. I think it is one of the core problems that if we address it well, which I think I have an inkling of how to do, you know, it can give us some hope for us to be able to transcend our limitations and be intentional about what we want out of our little blue spaceship and ourselves and where we want to be. And that's very exciting to me and also sounds really fun.
Do you want to mention any projects you're working on now before we sign
up? I'm discussing with some of my former partners and colleagues how we're going to do this and set it up. And I think sometime in the next 6 months or so, it'll be operationally and funding and building it out. And it's going to be really fun. I got one more 20-year game here. I'm going to play, I don't know. What's that? The other game. I love Hearts. I always used to shoot the moon.
Oh yeah. Shoot the moon. Go for it.
Go for it. I'd like to shoot the moon to figure out what health is and deliver us freedom from the uncertainty of that part of our lives.
Well, thanks so much for talking to me. I think you're a very interesting and smart guy, in my humble opinion. And I think you've done amazing things. And I think I'm fascinated to see what you come up with next.
No, it's a pleasure, Zach. And I'm glad you reached out.
This has been Jamie Haywood. And thanks.
Thank you.
This has been the People Who Read People podcast with me, Zach Elwood. If you want to learn more about this podcast, go to readingpokercells.video/blog, where I have episode summaries and links. You can follow Jamie Haywood on Twitter @JamieHaywood. I currently make no money on this podcast, and it takes a good amount of time to work on. So if you want to say thanks, I appreciate any social media shares about the podcast or giving any ratings on the podcast platform you listen on. And if you felt like throwing me a financial donation, I have a Patreon at patreon.com/ZachElwood. That's Z-A-C-H Elwood. Or my PayPal email address is info@readingpokertells.com. Thanks for listening. Music by Small Skies.